Resources and Hawaiian Affairs in the House. The members that are here today, myself and Vice Chair Mullian, and Member Yamane and Say. And Rep. Cullen and the House Labor Committee. We have Chair Nakashima.
And for the Senate Waterman, myself, Senator Clarence Mishikar, and Senator Sampson.
Yeah, I want to thank everybody for coming, the industry folks, the department, the advocates, and all the members, Vice Chair's office, my staff for helping arrange media. This is in response to the alleged reported human trafficking and deplorable, inhumane working conditions right here in Honolulu Harbor on our docks. We wanted a chance for the industry to explain for the department which actions can we take, and for the advocates to give their side of the story as well. For me, it was very alarming personally as chair of this committee to see those reports. It picked up nationally, internationally really, being reprinted on hundreds of publications across the globe, and folks are really watching us here today in Hawaii. So it's imperative that we do something, and I want to thank you folks for being here and being leaders and deciding to take action. In a sense, we're all accountable here, whether or not we're directly culpable. We, as lawmakers, have created an environment, a legal environment, which may allow this to happen. Same goes for culture in the industry, and even advocates for inaction over time. So in that spirit, I think we all have the same goals of ending any type of human trafficking happening here in Hawaii, setting an example for sustainable fishing and responsible fishing for the world, and with the future of our fisheries in mind as well. Nobody wants to decimate the industry. We just want humans to be treated as they should. So that was the purpose of the hearing, and I'm very thankful that Senator Gabbard was able to bring the Senate committee here as well. So Senator Gabbard.
Thank you, Aloha Kako, and good morning. I want to acknowledge Chair Ng's work on this issue, and I'm hopeful that today's discussion will provide us with more information on how to proceed forward as we go forward. We'll of course want to work closely with our congressional delegation, as it appears many of the issues are connected with existing federal law. And I think for all of us in this room and elsewhere, ultimately we want to ensure that these foreign fishermen are treated with the respect and the dignity that they deserve.
All right, so we're going to get started with the Division of Aquatic Resources. Mr. Bruce Anderson, you can brief us on what information. What your department has been doing to address this issue, and how we could help you as well.
Morning, Chair Ng. Morning, Dr. Gabbard. I'm Bruce Anderson. I'm the Division Administrator for the Division of Aquatic Resources, which is part of the Department of Land and Natural Resources. I'll describe very briefly our role in this issue, and hopefully can answer questions you might have about our commercial fishing license. How this might play into some of the issues that are on the table. The Division of Aquatic Resources issues a commercial marine license to all commercial fishermen in the state. There are about 3,400 licenses issued every year. You need a license to be able to sell fish in the state of Hawaii. And anyone who sells fish, even on weekends, would need to have a commercial license. And that, of course, the long-line fishing fleet. Out of the 3,400 licenses or so, about 700 of those are issued to those involved in the long-line industry. Those are the captains and crew of the vessels that are based here in Hawaii, primarily Pier 1617 and Pier 38 in that area. Last count, there are about 142 big eye and other fish, giant fish that have high commercial value. Most of those fish are sold to the fish auction. I'm sure we'll have speakers talking more about the process of sales and so forth. But again, our rule is fairly limited. Let me explain very briefly why we issue a license. Our job is to manage the fishery. We require that the fishermen report what they catch, where they catch it, and of course how much fish they're catching. And based on that information, we can then determine whether or not fish are being over whether there's any overfishing and make appropriate changes in the regulations. There are limits, for example, on bottom fish that resulted from evidence that a lot of fisheries are stressed and is not sustainable. So there are limits on how many bottom fish can be caught, paka paka, naga, and so forth. Likewise, there are limits on big eye and other tunas, which are heavily fished throughout the Pacific area. Many of you may remember the big eye limits were reached actually last July, I believe, and the fleet has been able to use quotas that have been allocated to other jurisdictions, American Samoa, CMI, and Guam, to help allow them to continue to fish in these federal waters for big eye. But again, our main interest is in knowing who's catching what where, and so we can better manage the fishery. We were not involved with labor issues. Like many people at the table here, we're all very concerned about disparate pay, working conditions, and other issues on these vessels. And I think those are the issues that I remember being the issues that we need to focus on when we look at some of the problems associated with the longline industry. We have a very accurate database that is up to date, that documents who's fishing. We have names of all the fishermen, whether they're crew or captains of the vessels. We do have personal identifying information, contact information, which of course is confidential. We know whether they're citizens or not U.S. citizens. We know what vessel they're assigned to. And of course, we keep that data up to date. So we're a good repository for information on who's out there fishing. And again, our main interest is in making sure that we are managing the fishery. You all know DLNR is focused on natural resources. We are not involved with labor issues. There are many other departments here who can speak to those probably better than we can. I would add that the DOCARE, Division of Conservation and Enforcement, is regularly inspecting these vessels. They do it randomly, so it's not announced, of course, but they do go aboard the vessels to make sure that all the fishermen have licenses. That's done frequently. And of course, there are other agencies that do come to the vessels to inspect the vessels from time to time. And I think they can speak to what their role is in the process. But we at DAR take our role very seriously and keeping track of who's fishing. And again, Bill Kerr does a good job, I think, of inspecting the vessels to make sure that all the fishermen have licenses. They are not looking at sanitary conditions on the boats. They're not, of course, privy to what the fishermen are being paid and some of the other issues that I know are concerned to you all. With that, I think that's pretty much as much as I wanted to say. I do have a copy of the application for a commercial marine license. And let me just add a little more to the process. That might be of some value to you. So what happens when someone needs a license is they will complete an application form, or someone completes it for them. They must present, if they're not a U.S. citizen, present identifying information, which is invariably a passport. We've actually had situations where passports have been expired, and of course we don't issue a license if they have an expired passport, but we use that to make sure that the person the application that's been submitted is submitted with an appropriate passport. And for the non-U.S. citizen, another form that's critically important to us is called the I-95 form. It's a form issued by the Department of Homeland Security, which says in essence that that the individual has the right to fish in U.S. waters, but cannot step ashore. And that helps us understand whether or not that person has been given that privilege, if you will, of fishing in U.S. waters. That's not a permit we issue, of course, and it's issued by the Department of Homeland Security, but we do require that of any non-U.S. citizen. As some of you know, there is a waiver in federal law that allows for less than 75% of the crew to be a non-U.S. citizen for fishing fleets that are targeting highly migratory species. That includes most of the long-line fishermen that they're targeting, big eye, swordfish, other fish that are pelagic fish and traveling great distances. It would be clearly defined as highly migratory. That is a variance, an allowance in the federal statutes that is largely an accommodation to the fact that many of the long-line vessels are unable to or have difficulty finding U.S. citizens to serve as crew members for that industry. It's been in place for decades, and singles out the long-line industry from other industries. And by the way, this is applicable not only to Hawaii, but to other jurisdictions as well. So that's maybe helpful to you all. Again, I'm glad to answer any questions you might have on our role, and we look forward to working with you and other agencies, state and federal agencies, to help to address some of the issues that have been come to our attention.
Thank you for your testimony. Unlike other briefings, we're going to take questions directly after the testifier. So, members of the House.
If you could, I'd be happy to pass out the copy of the application form. That will give you some information on exactly what's in our files on these fishermen. I mentioned that we have names, of course, personal identifying information and other information. While you're looking at that, let me also add, you'll probably be hearing about it later today, there was a petition filed to our Board of Land and Natural Resources to amend our rules to require some information that allegedly was not being collected by the agency as we issued the marine licenses. The Land Board last Friday ruled to deny the petition based on the fact that we're already collecting that information. And as you read your application, you can see that it's fairly complete in terms of what we are asking for. And further, that this was not an effective way to go after the issues that were most concerned. Again, that had to do with working conditions on the vessel, and pay disparities, which I think were the issues that the AP article raised, and probably the reason why we're all here.
Okay, any questions from the House members? Okay, I have a question.
First of all, I'd like to welcome Senator Glenn McKay and Senator Mishari. A question?
Yeah. Dr. Anderson, the issues of sanitation, health of crew, that falls under Homeland Security. What is it?
The Department of Labor is probably the agency that would be most concerned about those kinds of issues. OSHA, here at the state, under the Department of Labor and Industrial Relations, is the key state agency that enforces Department of Commerce labor laws. So most of those fall under Department of Commerce, is the federal authority, and authority has been delegated to the state to deal with those issues here, primarily through DLIR and OSHA.
Because the crews are foreign crews, right? Do the those federal agencies, do they really have any clout in terms of enforcing anything?
I would have to defer to someone from those departments as to what authorities they do have.
even if you guys did go out to inspect, there was nothing you could really do about it. Authoritative in terms of responsibility.
That's absolutely true. And I think as you contemplate the issues, you're going to need to understand that the agencies are first granted authorities by you to take care of issues. And again, getting back to DLNR, even if we were to find a problem with DLNR, as it related to sanitation or pay or whatever the issue might be, we wouldn't have the authority to do anything about it. First of all, I'm not sure we have the expertise to know what's acceptable and what's not, but even if we were to make a determination, we would not have the statutory authority to do anything about it.
Sure, but that's one follow-up question.
You said 75% of the crew has to be foreign, right? Has to be foreign,
no,
or could be.
Can be, excuse me, if I misspoke, if I said that.
Could be 100%.
Yes, I believe it could be. As I remember it, the federal waiver allows for less than 75% of the crew to be foreign. So it could be 100% foreign crew, whereas the vessels require that at least 75% of the crew be U.S. citizens. If it were any other fishery besides a fishery that was targeting highly migratory species, it would be to have 75% of the crew be a U.S. citizen.
So if there was among the crew a U.S. citizen, would then the U.S. have authority over that and the states have authority over those individuals?
That's a very good question. I believe that is true. I'm not sure what the rules are as it relates to labor and sanitation on a vessel, on any fishing vessel. But many other provisions would apply for U.S. citizens. They have rights that non-U.S. citizens do not have as it relates to health and so forth.
So the crews, when the captain files it for his vessel, does he have to list the names and where the crew comes from?
The captains typically, because the crew can't set foot on U.S. soil, the captains typically bring in, or their agents will bring in, the application with the passport and the I-95 forms. The form of the application signed, so obviously the applicant has had a chance to see it. And they will bring them in on their behalf, and we will issue the permits. Permits, a $50 charge for each of the licenses. And actually, that's going to go up to $100. But they'll bring in whatever licenses need to be renewed, or if there's an application for a new license, they'll bring those in on behalf of the crew member. But the licenses are issued to the individual crew members. So every crew member on the boat needs to have a commercial fishing license. That's the way the law currently works. In the past, this is many, many years ago, we used to license the vessel, and only part of one license. But now, the way the current rules are written, everyone fishing, including the crew, have to have a commercial marine license.
What if they're not English speaking? Can they really understand the form that they have to be signing?
Well, in most cases, they have people who are bilingual on the boats. They can explain the form to them. If you look at the conditions in the form simply requires that they need to know they require a license, and that if they don't have a license, they're in violation. It really doesn't require a lot of other information or anything on the part of the crew, other than that they report what they catch. That's really the criteria for the license. That's really all we are focused around. Obviously, the information has to be complete, and the person signs this form to the best of their ability to be sure that that information is complete. Their true name, which we can check against the passport. There's both a business address and a contact address line there. So I would assume that they would be able to complete that thoroughly. We're personal identity isn't we rely on the captains or others on the vessel to be sure that the applicant has completed the forms thoroughly. And that's how it's worked so far. In the old days, when the boats used to be at Kewalla Basin, when the fleet was here, and we actually had a staff that went aboard the vessel, but there were far fewer vessels, and times were very different then.
One question for mine. Is it common practice for the captains to hold on to all the passports of the crew?
I wouldn't know if that is common practice. Of course, again, when the application comes in, it has to be accompanied by a passport. But I couldn't answer that question. Someone else would need to talk about the practice.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have thank you. I had a follow-up question regarding licenses. Does the captain come to DAR or do you both go to the boat? And has it always been that way?
I've only been there a year. But I believe in the past,
is Alton
10 years.
Could Alton join you?
Alton is.
Yeah.
You know, Alton. I'm more to do with this.
Did you answer that question?
Alton is Saka. Yes, we used to go out to the vessels to issue the licenses when there weren't that many boats, as Dr. Nissen said. We've discontinued that likely because we don't have the necessary staff to be able to go out to the vessels regularly. There's also issues of safety and access and liability when you go onto the private vessels. A lot of times, our licensed agents are younger females. They need to go with someone else with them. So we need a licensed enforcement officer to go with them just to ensure safety. And so the burden, I guess, of having to go out to the vessel whenever the vessel needed a license was something that we couldn't continue.
So currently, the captain goes to DAR, gets a bunch of applications, brings it back to his crew, they fill it out. So you never see contact with the individual crew members?
Usually not.
Does that comply with Hawaii statute and administrative rules?
Yes.
We've been through these procedures with our AG, and there's no violation of the rules. Under the circumstances, obviously, the crew can't come to the office. That would be a violation of their detention order, if you will, which required that they be on the boat, and so it would put the throw into a catch-22 situation, obviously. Let me emphasize, though, that the field care officers who do go aboard the vessels, and they do check to make sure that the fishermen themselves have current licenses.
Does the department agree, back to the language question, that more than an insubstantial amount of licenses have been given to folks with limited English proficiency?
Many of the fishermen are, most of them are professional fishermen, but they're from countries such as Indonesia, Philippines, Hawaii. Those are the three that I think comprise most of the crew members. Again, we can actually let you know with the license program, I believe, what the breakdown is. Countries where individuals are coming, and many of them do not speak English, certainly don't speak it fluently.
You mentioned there's no translators. What steps will the department take to comply with Title VI, I believe, of the Civil Rights Act to provide translation services to its applicants?
We have the ability to provide interpretive services if requested of us. To the extent that there are interpreters available, some languages are so obscure that there isn't any, but the assumption is that the crew member on the board has to be able to communicate with the captain and the other members of his crew in order to understand what the duties are as required of them, when they're required of them. So there is communication that way, and so we're assuming that if you're on the vessel, if someone is providing you the application, if you have any questions,
assumptions.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so
okay.
We're asked, we would provide.
Does the department have a plan for language access? And who's responsible for executing that plan personally in the department?
Well, Canada, we never found a problem with this issue. Never had any complaints, never had any issues that are associated with not having provided the appropriate information in the forum. But if there were for whatever reason.
This is just based on the Associated Press article that talks about barriers to language access, and how often these folks may not, the workers may not actually understand the contracts or applications, even some of the orders on the folks. So just in that context, this isn't coming directly from me, it's coming from the article. What is the department's position?
And then we would, if someone were to request services, we could probably find those. If there was a contract between the fisherman and the owner, for example, I think it'd be far more important that the individual understand the terms of that contract. Again, the only reason for our issuing the licenses is so that we can get information on the number of fish they've caught and where they've caught it. And that doesn't seem to be an issue. No one has challenged the data. I don't know if there's been any problem associated with not having a complete application as it relates to our commercial marine license. So I would suggest that if there were interpretive services necessary, it would be in the area of wanting to make sure that they understood the terms of the contract or something along that line. But again, our position would be if someone asked for a translator, we would certainly look to see if we could find one.
I know you mentioned that DAR handles the fishing applications for the purpose of taking marine life for commercial purposes, not necessarily the labor side. But you folks are the only department currently with a record of everybody that are out fishing, all the longliners, the ships, the crews. So that's why this is a vital piece to finding a solution here, and it's under DAR. You mentioned work contracts. The issue with the work contract from our past meetings with the industry and others is that there is no direct crew to owner contract. The owner will have a contract with the agency from the Philippines or the Kiribati, wherever, and that agency will have a contract with the worker. That contract usually ends up somewhere abroad, and we don't have access to that, but we should. When someone's applying to fish with DAR, you need to know they're here to fish. So shouldn't you request that agency contract to know why they're here, and not just assume they're going to fish and report later? Could you add the requirement to see the agency contract to the application process for licensure?
We would entertain that prospect if that were something that the legislature looked at. Again, we couldn't follow up to do anything about it if they didn't. We wouldn't have that authority to require a contract with anyone else. Our authorities are somewhat limited. I agree. I can't think of another agency that has the list of names. And again, we'd be very happy to provide information that might be helpful to the committee and others along that line. Unless whatever is confidential, of course. I would be somewhat hesitant to put on a lot of other conditions as for licensure, such as having a contract. I'm not sure how you word that and have it apply only to the longline fishermen or whatever, because again, that's the focus of what we're doing. Keeping in mind, we issue lots of commercial licenses for other purposes as well, so somehow you have to differentiate between the longline fishermen and others.
If you're working through an agency, you should provide the agency contract, just so we know exactly what you're here to do. This helps advocates if you want to do a spot check later, because everyone in this room says they're committed to ending any of these bad apples or any of these things happening. But if they are isolated incidents, we need to isolate the incidents. And the way we do that is through this list. Let's say if you have an agency contract behind the DAR desk, an auditor wants to see it, they can request it, bring it with them as a reference during the spot check and say, this is what you agreed to sign. Are these conditions being met on the boat? Without it, people are just, they're in the dark. So
if you have a database with all the crew members and where they're from, whether they're foreign national, why not also which agency they're contracted under?
We don't know that. Alden, do you have any thought on how we might be able to leverage our licensure program to get to that information?
And I think what you're talking about is a private contract between the agency and the fishermen who hired them. Whether or not the state has the ability to require copies of that contract, that would be up to the legislature to decide and to legislate.
Well, it could be through rulemaking as well, right?
Well, we don't have the authority to require private contract information because it's not related to our.
It's related. Are you here to fish? Show me proof that you're here to fish.
Well, that's what the I-95 form is for.
I-95 is an importation form. That's legally absurd.
It says that they can legally be on the vessel for the purpose of fishing.
That's, again, a determination made by the Department of Homeland Security. Let me suggest that I probably won't have a chance to do this much. You know, there are lots of ways to get at this issue. One is, of course, to eliminate that variance that allows for less than 75% of the crew to be U.S. citizens. The other is, and there are lots of hoops for this, but temporary work visa, which is the way migrant farmer workers are handled. That assures that they have health insurance, assures that they're given a reasonable place to live, and it doesn't require that they necessarily be paid what a minimum wage would be. So they can negotiate the pay, but at least those basic conditions are met with the temporary work visa. Now, I don't know the hoops that you have to go through to get that, but the reason that we have migrant workers working in the U.S. is because they can't find U.S. citizens to do the job. That's the reason for the temporary work visas. It's the same situation for the fishing industry. So maybe that's an avenue to pursue.
No,
I would get to the issue much
we
more.
We can explore federal options, but you know, I think for me the purpose of this is what can we do through our roles, because we all, you know, are saying that we're going to do whatever it takes. So you know, in the interest of not punting to the federal, to Congress, you know, what can we do here at DAR? You say vessel checks are frequent by DOCARE. What exactly are they looking for? Is it just that they have their licenses? How often do they take place? And is it at random, or do the vessels know beforehand? And do you think these DOCARE officers would be open to coming in with an auditor, a third-party independent auditor alongside them?
No, I don't know if there's anyone from DOCARE here. My understanding is the inspections are unannounced. That they do focus on whether or not they have a commercial mining license, and they would verify the identity at that point and cite someone who did not have a commercial marine license on the vessel. But I don't know much more than that.
Could they also check if they have a contract to fish, so they're not just there for fun or for another reason?
Well,
that
they don't have their commercial marine license essentially is their contract to fish, is the way I see it. That's an authority from the state of Hawaii saying you can fish.
But the application doesn't require a contract to fish.
It's no contract, no. Again, if they have an I-95 form, it's called a crewman's landing permit. That's a language term, crewman's landing permit. And they have a valid passport. That's all they need in our view.
But so you see my line of thinking, it just right now, if you want to touch these labor violations, you need to compare it what's happening with the agency, what they agreed to in the agency contract. But in order to uncover those agency contracts, we need to work with some department. DAR seems like a reasonable department to work through, because you folks need to know they're here to fish. So why not request the contract that says we're here to fish in your licensure?
I think this is a question we should probably close to the AG, and just to find out if that's something we could add to our list of requirements for fishing. We're talking about it now. We're not opposed to that, as long as it's a checkoff on our list of requirements for getting the permit, and it isn't that requires to go out and actually verify that they've understood the terms of the contract and all that other stuff that you probably are also concerned about. That's something we'd entertain.
Great.
But I do think we need to get an opinion from the AG, as often pointed out, we may not have the authority to require a contract under our current under the current statutes.
Okay. You mentioned that, I mean, you agreed that you're the only department with these records. Do you share those records with other state or federal agencies?
We would on request, of course. And again, it doesn't take us long to turn that around. 24 hours, I could give you all a list of all the fishermen that are fishing in Hawaii.
Do you currently regularly to the Department of Labor, the DLIR?
No, we haven't been requested to provide that. We're actually provided to one of the news media stations, but the other departments have not asked for a listing of those, as far as I know. But we, again, we have those records, and we're very happy to provide that information.
So how many, Bruce, do you have undocumented? More fishermen on farm?
About 700. 700 longliners. Again, we've got about 3,400 commercial fishermen. Out of those, 700 are longliners. That changes, of course, from time to time, but that's a good rough figure. And again, my understanding is about 142 boats currently operating out of Hawaii. Plus five crew members, including the captain on each boat.
Okay, that was my last question. I'm going to give you the last word.
I keep hearing the Department of Labor being tossed out there, but my understanding from the Department of Labor is that there is no jurisdiction once you get onto the water of fair labor standards and all that. Mine is State Department of Labor. So have you discuss this with the State Department of Labor regarding their jurisdiction?
I haven't. Let me ask Alden if he's had a chance to do that.
My inquiry is that the OSHA, I didn't contact Labor Division from Labor Department, so I did not have a discussion about what their limits of their authorities are.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, could you speak more about the jurisdiction of the department regarding, let's see, the exclusive economic zone within the state marine waters?
Okay, well, I'll try to explain that best I can. So the state basically controls waters out to 3 miles. That's our job. DAR's job is to regulate fishing within that 3 mile limit. Out to the end of the exclusive economic zone, which is 200 miles out from shore, the U.S. federal government, NOAA in particular, regulates fishing in that area. Actually, most of the longline data that comes in is from fish caught within the EEZ or in international waters even further out than 200 miles. Typically what happens is when a vessel comes in, say a longliner comes into Pier 38, they will submit a form to essentially what is forever NOAA listing the catch for that voyage. Usually it's a 3 or 4 week voyage. And that data is compiled and then provided to their researchers and also back to us. So we get the information indirectly from the longliners. The data on the commercial catches for almost everything else that comes in comes directly to the department, back to the DAR. We actually compile that data and report on that. But essentially, the waters within the U.S. economic zone are U.S. waters where U.S. fishermen are allowed to fish, and only if they have a permit from NOAA. Again, they need a permit from DAR in order to sell fish here in Hawaii. But anyone who's fishing within the EEZ needs a federal permit. You don't need a permit if you're going out beyond the EEZ. Say if you go out 300, 400 miles out, you can fish there, but you couldn't come back through the EEZ, nor would you sell your fish in Hawaii. You'd have to go back to some other place.
I see. That answers my question. Okay. Any other questions from House members?
One other question. Could you supply the committee with a list of the undocumented fishermen, the 700 that you?
We can. Let me ask specifically what I believe we can provide would be if they're a U.S. citizen or not, probably what country they came from, what vessel they're on.
Generally, any kind of personal contact information is used for that. For things like what license you have, when does it expire, what type of license.
Obviously, passport number, social security number, telephone numbers, all those things we would not have for you. But it'll give you a good sense of who's out there and probably what countries they're from. I hope to answer that question. Yes, we can provide that to you if you'd like that.
That would be helpful, thank you.
And again, in future, maybe we could add agencies to that list as well. And you mentioned the license expiring. How long does the license last and how often do you come back?
The annual license. So they need to update. So our list will be within the last year. It'll be current. And again, I don't know that we can require the agency who has essentially contracted with the fishermen. That may or may not be something we can require. I'm certain it's not part of our current information. So that's something we'll explore going forward.
All right. Well, thank you for doing that, Ernest. And thank you for taking the time. I know you have a 12 o'clock, so.
Yeah, appreciate your accommodation. Alden will be able to stay to answer questions. I'll be better than I can. Thank you.
Next up is Jim Cook, representing Pacific Ocean Producers and the Hawaii Longline Association. Still in San Francisco.
So I think it would be helpful to all of you if I gave you sort of a brief history of foreign crews in Hawaii, and then it might help sort of put things in context. the long life history in Hawaii began to grow very rapidly in the mid to late 80s. Up until that time, we were between 40 and 50 boats here. We used crews that were primarily from compact states, federated states in Micronesia, Marshall Islands, for the same. And when the industry began to rapidly grow, which is in the late 80s, the industry went from about 50 boats to 143 in a time span of 5 years. And as you may imagine, it was very, very difficult to get crew, and especially qualified crew. In 1988, I think that's about 27 or 28 years ago, this provision in the law allowed foreign crew members to enter the fishery. Since we are 100% pelagic fisheries, we could use foreign crew members, and our fleet began to utilize foreign crew members. So procedurally, what happens is that a vessel owner contacts an agent in the country. In the Philippines, it's been the majority supplier of labor. There are many agents in the Philippines, and it's a highly regulated industry by the Philippine Overseas Employment Agency. So you contact an agent, you tell them what your crew needs are, maybe you need 5 people. He'd probably send you a list of 15 people. You'd vet the list, looking for experience, and particularly for us, looking for experience with guys that have been in Hawaii before. You pay the agent a fee, normally somewhere between $500 and $700. You have a contract that the agent puts out that describes the terms of employment of the fisherman that he's sending you. And from there on, you would buy an airplane ticket from Manila to Honolulu. You would pick the individual up at the airport. He would enter Hawaii on what is known as a T1D visa, which is a crew or a transit visa for people who are joining vessels or aircraft, or whether they're in Honolulu or from foreign countries. At that point, he would become detained on board the vessel when he reached it. After 9/11, there was a concern that the countries that we were dealing with, which were primarily Indonesia and the Philippines, had Muslim population, and the concern was that this could be used as a methodology to bring these sorts of terrorist people into the United States. And for that reason, they disallowed the C1D visa. So what that meant to those of us in the business is, because there was no visa, the individual could not ride an airplane from country of origin to Honolulu. So we ended up having to pick these people up in foreign ports. The most well-used port for that purpose is American Samoa, which is American, of course, but it's a free port. So the procedure basically became, get your crew member, get him to American Samoa, get him into the hands of an agent there, get him from the airport to the boat, drive your boat to American Samoa, put your crew members aboard, come back to Honolulu, get documented in through Customs and Border Patrol, get your I-95, and begin your trip fishing. So from that time, since 9/11, up until now, there is the same situation. We're having to transit to one port. We also go to Ensenada, we also go to Vancouver, we go wherever we need to go. Distances are the big question. The cost of taking a boat out of service for a month and trying to pick it up for a minute is about $50,000 to $75,000. So now we have our crew members. I'd like to speak a little to the issue of the difference between a domestic and a foreign crew. Foreign crew members really are the same as domestic crew members. If we look at the issue, two issues that I think are important to the committee, that being working conditions and pay. An American crew member on a boat, if the vessel has less than 10 crew members, since way back in the early 70s, I believe, is allowed to be treated as an individual contractor. And in fact, in most fisheries throughout the United States, they are treated like individual contractors. The Coast Guard requires that we have a contract with that crew member, American crew member, that lays out terms of employment and pay. So if you will agree that what Michigan was paying for 0.001%, you can go and come back and I'll hand you half a penny. That is entirely legal under that system. They are their own contractors. They have a contract with the boat, whatever the term that is, what they're offering. When it comes down to working conditions and working hours, I don't believe in any captured fishery in the world that you would ever have a situation where somebody would recognize what we do as having sort of the confines of a 40-hour week, an 8-hour day, or anything even close to it. Fishing has, around the world, always been a situation where you have times where you're just riding around the ocean and then you've got times when you start to work. All of us work, whether you're foreign or you're domestic. It's not at all unusual to work more than 24 hours in a day. The nature of the business, whether you're here, whether you're craft fishing in Alaska, whether you're salmon fishing in Oregon, that's how these vessels operate. Let's see what else. I think that's it. So what we're doing as an association is we have, what we're trying to do, a rapid assessment of our crews. And so we are out, we have a person who is doing these assessments that we have hired, who has significant experience doing this kind of work, who's gone through more than half the fleet at this point. I'll let Dr. Canepo, when he comes up, tell you about this part of it. We did also retain an expert, Katrina Nakamura, who is here, who will be able to address the crew contract. The crew contract, I'll just say before she comes up, is basically designed as a contract between the vessel and the fisherman to assure that the terms and conditions that follow on that contract do not contribute to human trafficking or slavery. So if you would allow, those two people will cover those elements of it. And I'd be glad to take any questions that you have.
Thank you, Jim. Okay. Thank you for taking the time. I'll just start with the science side.
Any questions on the science side? I have a question, Jim. In prepping for this info briefing, I was told that 50% of the longline fishing boats do not have a functioning toilet for the crew to use. And given our recent experience with Hep A, the outbreak here, I find it quite startling. Why don't
I can't confirm the 50%. I think there's more than that. And I don't know.
You say there's more than that?
No, I think it's less than that.
All right.
I think it's more important.
Okay.
So I don't know the answer to how many vessels don't have toilets. I understand that some of them don't. It's very common in the fishing business. You know, if we have a calm day today and come Friday night, 150 boats will leave ports in Hawaii with no toilets, with no bunks, with no facilities to cook food and go fishing, and they come back Monday morning and brag to you about how much fun they have. So I don't think it's a bigger concern in our business as it is in some.
Anyone else that's testifying today or that you could refer us to who could answer that question?
As to how many boats there are, I really don't think so. I mean, it's not something that I know of. I think when we're through with our survey, which we anticipate to be in 2 weeks or on the first month, we could answer.
Thank you.
Members? Jim, you own 20 boats or so.
No, I own 6.
You own 6 boats.
Yeah.
Do your boats have toilets?
Yes. Yeah.
So can you explain the purpose and work of Hawaii Longline Association? Exactly what work do you protect? The owners?
Yeah.
Is it the workers?
So,
do you represent the workers?
In the late 1990s, a series of procedural lawsuits were filed against the National Marine Fisheries Service for violating basic rules of procedure. And of course, when they filed against the National Marine Fisheries Service, it affects the owners. So a group of us got together and started Hawaii Longline Association to be able to fund attorneys to intervene in these lawsuits. funded somewhere in the level of $600,000 to $700,000 a year. 90% of that is spent in defending lawsuits. We have been involved in 13 separate actions since it started, and we have prevailed in 12 of them. And our primary concern is exactly that, legal defense. When this came up, it was the obvious concerns of all our members, so we became involved in this issue. We have a board of directors, we meet basically monthly, and like I said, primarily legal defense.
So you represent these 142 long-running voters? Is that the number?
We actually represent the permit holders. There's 164 permit holders. There's 142 active vessels. Of those 142 active vessels, I'm going to say around 135 of them are in Hawaii. There's a couple of just operating out of LA, San Diego.
Is there some kind of standard or policy set for membership of HLI? Or is that what you call it? Is that what it is?
Yeah, HLA, that's what we call it. Yeah, you have to have a permit, a Hawaii long-line permit, and you need to pay your dues.
Okay, and so there's no like, policies like you folks need to have toilets?
No, or,
okay. Not even, there's no standards like you if you want to be part of Hawaii Long Line Association, you cannot be human trafficking.
There is no standard.
There's no standard.
No.
Is that something you'll be open to including in the future as part of your membership?
Well, we're working towards that. Once we get wrapped around what the actual situation is out on the dock through the staff survey, I think it will probably lead us down the road to some sort of set of standards. Like any trade association, we don't desire to be a replacement for our membership, but it is a good idea to set standards and probably do that.
Well, I mean, there are other models out there. You know, I know you represent the owners, but in other states, there are unionized crews of fishermen.
Yeah, fishermen.
Do you represent the workers, too, or are they on their own?
As I said, we represent the interests of the holders of Hawaii Longline Permit.
So not the crew members, per se. So who represents them?
You know, I think they represent themselves.
So you're a boat owner. Can you explain your side of the DAR application process if you want to apply for a permit for your vessel or your crew?
Yeah, I actually am not involved in that, and I don't hold a permit, but I can tell you my understanding of it. The captain of the vessel, of course, has to be an American citizen. He, of course, has to have a license, and he applies exactly the way Bruce explained through DAR. For the license for themselves and for those crews. So what we do administratively is assure ourselves that the crews have a license and that the captain has a license.
If, let's say if the workers were to organize or even go so far as to create a union, obviously it would be very difficult given that they're foreign national and temporary. How do you think that would affect the industry or what you do under HLA, would that open the door to more lawsuits perhaps? Or would you be supportive of those sorts of efforts?
I don't know that I'd be supportive. In terms of what it would do to HLA, we would continue to represent the interests of our community.
Where are your members, where do they prefer to get their foreign workers, their migrant workers? And are there any agencies or countries that they avoid?
Yeah, so if you look at the situation as it is today, I think I'm correct in saying around 60% are Filipino nationals. There's probably about 5% or so Kiribati. There may be around 10% Vietnamese, and the balance are Indonesian.
Okay. Are there agencies that you will decide not to work with for whatever reason?
I'm sure there have everybody. Each of these 142 permit holders are acting as an individual business, so I don't really get into their business. I can tell you for us what constitutes a good agent is people do their paperwork promptly and accurately, and all the financial parts of it flow smoothly. So in each of these countries, the Philippines is probably the most highly regulated, where the government actually regulates agents. I don't know how many matting agencies there are in the Philippines, but I think you guys have I've probably used three different ones in the Philippines. One of them just went out of business, we stopped using. We only use one in Indonesia, and I don't do a deal with it immediately.
Okay. You described the fishing conditions being that just the standard 20-hour days. I think for many of us, the concern isn't necessarily when you're out fishing, but when you docked, when you met the quota, and you're just floating outside the docks with no really structure of authority, or it's essentially just like this, you're just floating there at the whim of the captain for months at a time on the docks, and that's where they seem to be the most ripe for abuse, and they're not working. Why not, once they meet the quota, why not just send the workers home?
I think I have a fundamental misunderstanding of the quota. So our vessels fish for tuna and tuna associated species. They also fish for swordfish. So there is no quota. The only quota in the whole Hawaii long line fleet has to do with one species, big eye tuna. So that quota, when it's met, our boats will continue to fish. We don't serve that one.
Oh, then let me rephrase the question. Why are these boats stopped? And why aren't these people fishing for extended periods of the time?
You may have a vessel that's docked for some kind of maintenance. My boats average lasting 287 days a year. I don't think I'm untypical. I mean, we're in port 80 to 100 days a year. A lot of our time that we're in port has to do with loading, unloading, cleaning, getting ready to go. So we don't have this sort of vast idle time that you think.
Okay, so reports of those are falsified.
I didn't say they're falsified. I said we don't have them.
But it's been reported that there are crews floating.
I haven't read the reports of these times.
You read the Associated Press article?
Yes.
Okay. There evidence, did we give any calls that there's been a lot of things happening on the docks? One allegation is there have been prostituted women that are being brought to the men on the crews who've been confined to these spaces with, just other men for months at a time. Are you aware of that happening, and what's HLOA's position?
I've heard of that, and I can't swear to it, but I don't think that HLA has a position on that. I can tell you that the board of directors of Pier 38 has a position on that, and that is we are preparing to have our security people escort these people off the premises.
Okay. How long have you known about these allegations?
Which one?
Slave-like practices aboard longline vessels.
September 8th.
That was the first time you heard about
yeah.
it. What about the 2013 story by KHON? What about the FBI investigation in 2012?
Remind me of that.
I think Gina Mangieri did a story in 2013 where she interviewed the relatives of some workers from the Kiribati, and they're describing a litany of slave-like conditions aboard the ships.
Were they prosecuted by the federal government, or what?
No, but it made it to the media as it did today. It was a smaller scale. It wasn't on hundreds of publications like it is now. But I'm sure you were aware of it.
I remember that there was something. I don't remember the exact situation.
Oh, so what action did you take then?
I didn't take any action.
There was a tent meeting that a federal agent had told us about in about 2011, where they discussed these sorts of issues as well. Were you in attendance then? It was with the Coast Guard and Attorney General at the time.
I don't think I was. I think you're referring to a meeting that may have occurred on Pier 16 and 17, and I did not attend it.
Okay. Have you ever been affiliated with Westpac?
Yes.
In what capacity?
As a member of Westpac for 9 years and as chair for 2.
During the Papahānaumokuʻākea monument expansion, Westpac wrote a letter to the Associated Press thanking them for uncovering slave-like conditions aboard foreign vessels in Thailand and a few others. They shared it with the members of the legislature, boasting about
aboard we are here at home, and how it's a shame that we patronize these boats, and they use very insidious language like rape and pillage abroad without supporting our husbandry at home while this was happening on our docks. Now the Associated Press article happens, comes out, and the Westpac agenda just last month did nothing. You know, this is such a huge concern for us, these allegations of slavery. But when it's reported as happening now, there was no action. Could you explain that discrepancy?
I can't. I haven't been a member of Westpac for 16 years. So I can't speak.
You know, as a boat owner, could you explain the process of hiring a foreign fisher? Is there a direct contract between the owner or the captain and the worker, or is there a middle person, as in a foreign agency? And how does that exactly play out?
Yeah. Well, so basically, once again, this is what happens. We are looking for crew. We make contact, an agent in our case, might be in the Philippines, it might be in Indonesia. They will bring us crews, and they said, who would you like to have? We'll look around, try to find the best qualified ones we can. We'll go to them, and they will give us a contract signed by the crew member, as well as the agency. We sign it, and that's the beginning of it. And the normal way that the contract works, really, is that it specifies a wage. It could be as low as $350 a month. It could be as high as $700 or $800 a month. And then that contract, some of those contracts will specify bonuses. But standard practice in the industry is that we pay incentives to the crew members. So yes, there is a contract. I do have one for the crew members.
Okay. But most of the details on labor conditions or pay is in their agency contract.
Yes, that we all sign.
Does the captain have the agency contracts on hand of the crew?
Well, we have them in the office. The board member has them.
Okay. Could that be, if DAR wanted to have access to those, like say if it was part of the licensure requirements that you provide those agency contracts to the department, you feel that the owners should be able to do that? Or would that at least have the capacity to do it?
No.
Okay. That's all the questions I have. Thank you for being a good support, and I'll give you the final word if there's no questions on this side.
Well,
thank you, Ben. Next, we have Hawaii Seafood Council and the consultant on social impacts of supply chains. That's Dr. John Kaneko and Katrina Nakamura.
Excuse me. Coming up with the criteria
which actually will document or demonstrate situations in which force ranger exists, we've come up with an approach which is looking at crew contracts to make sure that we're addressing specifically the issues that have a criteria that have to do with force ranger. The allegations of substandard or poor working conditions on board fishing vessels is becomes a little bit more qualitative. We'd be looking for standards. I know we've been asking for standards. It's not, to my knowledge, there are no standards for the working conditions on the boats, but we look immediately towards what kind of government oversight is there on board vessels and what are people looking for. So that would be the U.S. government for safety controls, that would be investigations through the U.S. Coast Guard, make sure the ship is safe to operate. And then we have the Department of Homeland Security, the Customs and Border Patrol, that actually does vessel inspections. And part of their vessel inspection role is to be looking for indicators of forced labor, human trafficking. And to my knowledge, they have no standards for crew conditions or working conditions, but evidence of forced labor. And so those are the types of things that are going on. So the first thing was dealing with the crew contract. Second thing is getting involved with the investigation of what's going on with the fleet. Because as Jim was saying, there may be the Hawaii Longline Association, but the association was not involved with the business management and operation of each individual vessel. You have to look at these vessels as being individual small businesses, and each one is out hiring their own crew and maintain their own vessels. And so we are quickly, and I think pretty rapidly, trying to get a handle on where we are with this. And so with the fleet, what kind of conditions we're finding out there, the range of conditions. But first, to answer this question of human trafficking or not, that I see a lot of signs out here, and I would agree with everyone that has concerns about the allegations of forced labor, but I would reiterate is that until just recently, there hasn't been a case brought even against this one boat that's operating on San Francisco. So it's just happened now. So we'll see, take a look at that, and see if they'll come up with the evidence on forced labor. Mistreatment of the crew is another thing. And I think some of the issues that we need to delve into would be whether or not there is crew satisfaction in the contracts. And I think it's kind of interesting how some skippers I've talked to will answer that question. Oh, well, for instance, how long have you used these crewmen? I've had this crewman on board he's worked for me for 10 years. Well, that could be misinterpreted as he's been on the vessel confined for 10 years, but what they really mean is he's come back under numerous repeat contracts. And I think most people would agree that situations of slavery, that would not be coming back. Certainly not voluntarily. It would not re-up for his position.
Mm-hmm. Well, that kind of sounds like the domestic violence batterer argument, right? She keeps coming back.
No, but once you went home, why would you come back? Once you went home and you're free, repatriated, why would you come back?
You're not there are many reasons.
I would not draw that.
Desperate economic situations back home,
right.
You know, on democratic societies that
right.
are taken from.
Yeah, the reality is that there are 260. I'll just speak to the definition. So there are 260 million mm-hmm. people fishing right now in the fishing industry worldwide. It's a lot of people. And 65-70% of our seafood, 90% of our seafood in the U.S. comes from other countries. And about 70% of that is from developing countries. So a lot of the food we eat, a lot of the goods we use and in our everyday life are made in a kind of unregulated space. And in the last year, the federal government has closed a loophole which now makes it illegal to import many of these goods if they have ties for slavery. So this year is a very special year. We didn't really talk about this before, and now it's a very important issue for commodities across the spectrum. So apparel's been dealing with the forced labor issue for 20 years. They just celebrated a big anniversary, and they think they're getting through it at last. The mineral sector, maybe more like 8 years. Now it's fishing's turn. And it's fishing's turn because the Thai industry is built on forced labor. And that continues today, although there's been radical change in Thailand for the good, but it's still the case that 80-90% of the crew on boats are Burmese, and at least half of them are registered workers, and they need 10 pieces of paper to get placed into work, and there's a lot of exposure there for the crew. So we have, in this case, a story which was written by the same journalist who did a remarkable series in Thailand not long ago, exposing a lot of, sort of lifting the rock on the Thai industry, and now making a domestic story. So my name is Katrina. I have been working on the task of how can business respond to, so businesses are responsible for their own supply chains. So you may not know this, but US law for companies to be liable anywhere in their supply chain through the seller. If you're buying something from Walmart, they're liable to how that good was produced. Now this is sort of something business owners have been operating without really understanding, and now they have to all in a hurry. Well, they need tools to understand, because a lot of the goods are produced in, like I said, what you could call like a governance gap or a transparency gap. Supply chains, especially in seafood, are very complicated. Lots of gaps, lots of brokers, lots of subcontracting, very complicated. So my job, I'm an independent, but I've been working with the Humanity United, which is an organization, it's actually an OMIDR network organization, that is, its mandate is to end human atrocity, and one of their focal points is ending human trafficking in business. So I've been blessed to work with them for about 4 years to develop what we call the labor safe screen. I'll share, if anybody's interested, what our process is. But we work with, from the biggest retailers like Whole Foods and you know, Walmart, down to individual cases where people are trying to figure out what to do. And what happened in this case is on September 8th, there was a shock. And the first thing I saw happen through the Hawaii Seafood Council and HLA was a decision to get the vessel owners together. Kind of like a crackheads meeting. Like who's responsible here? And the very first thing I recommended is, if there's no contract that's super clear between vessel owner and crew, there needs to be one now. Because most internationally in fishing, most of the exposure to forced labor for crew comes from not having a contract. Like in the Thai industry, 94%, Big Island study, had no contract. You have to have a contract, but you don't have a legal, you know, clear relationship with your employer. And here in the U.S., like everywhere, employers have a duty to provide a safe workplace. They do, in the law. It's defined in various ways. Human trafficking is a little different because it's not as easy as thinking that because people are from migrant countries and don't have papers, that they're enslaved. Fishing is a pretty proud profession. It's also sometimes a highly skilled profession. And what we've heard so far in the fleet here, although we're certainly not done all of the listening, is that we have a pretty professional crew here, and we have folks that consider it quite an advantage to work on a U.S. boat relative to other boats. Some of them have worked on Taiwanese boats. You know, ask Dr. Chris about fishing crew on Taiwanese boats, a little bit different thing. So there is a problem we have now to resolve in the fleet that goes way beyond addressing the allegations of forced labor that the article speaks to without really giving much evidence. I'll get back to that, but what's really profoundly important right now is that the crew here understand and feel safe in their work. And one of the unfortunate fallouts, hopefully short term, from the article is that a lot of crew feel like their jobs are being eliminated. And others can speak to that better than me. It's one of the things that we found was very surprising. The first thing that the Hawaii Seafood Council asked me to be involved with was outreach to the community to understand what supports are available. John said, we don't care, right or wrong, we're not revisiting what's in this story, just find out who we can get, people who speak Kiribati, make sure we have a way to bridge the community to the crew. So I was asking a number of organizations locally if they had legal language or advocacy supports. That happened like immediately in the first 2 weeks. And, you know, variable success with finding people. It took us a few weeks to find all of the resources, like the Safe Gateway Center and so on. But what was surprising in that process is when I was talking to the people at the consuls, we just were having a really hard time finding anybody who had heard of a case yet. And at the same time, the vessel owners had agreed to implement immediately a contract. And it was really kind of like the way I understood what the owners wanted was a pact among vessel owners to make sure they're all on the same page. Because some of the owners, for example, Jim thought, you know, nobody's charging recruitment fees here. We pay all the costs. How could they say they're undocumented, you know, and they are responsible for fees? Because that's not true. But they didn't really know if that's true for all the boats. So the contract is a way to standardize, you know, the responsibility across the fleet.
You talked about the universal contract as responsible
yeah.
to the Whole Foods pulling out.
Yeah, well, it was, I don't know if it was so much responsible to Whole Foods pulling out, but it's just necessary. You need to have a contract. And it wasn't there, and I think so many things are produced this way, so some of these sectors are affected, but whenever you're subcontracting labor, and you have an indirect relationship with your employee, there's a lot of things that can go wrong. So the first thing was shut that down. So what the contract contains is extremely simple, but it only contains the items which would shut out exposures to forced labor. So the payment firms, identifiers, accountability for payment, timing of payment, minimums on payment, the statement that there should be no cost for the employee, the status, these things are there, but not much more. Because that was something that the fleet owners could be decisive about and agree to quickly, right? Since the contract was implemented and the auction has agreed to oversee it, and perhaps there'll be other forms of oversight in the future, which would be marvelous. Transparency is good, you know. Transparency is how you keep everybody accountable. Whatever happens with that, we have also have this process underway. John described with hearing directly from the crew. So we were part of some meetings initially where retailers were like, well, we send our auditor in. Can we send, you know, like check the box kind of auditing? Because frankly, there is no private standard which companies can use to go check if there's people that are enslaved. Like imagine auditing and having people really honestly tell you as an outside auditor, oh, P.S., I'm not being paid. The tricky thing in fishing is a lot of men don't know if they're being paid or not. If they're getting remittances home through an agency. Sometimes they're being paid, sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're charged fee X, sometimes they're charged fee Y. So now we know from the first round of interviews that we need to look closer at those recruitment relationships. And that will come, and I think we'll see, you know, some steps from the fleet towards more standardization there as well to clear things up.
Okay, I guess we'll move to questions. The House side. Rep Wall.
So this was created recently, then, right? According to what you're saying.
What do you have?
The universal crew contract?
Yes, that was done.
My question
yes.
is,
after
September 8th. Why wasn't it done earlier?
Why was it not done earlier?
Yeah, why was something like this not created earlier? Was there never a need for that? Just in all
I think the question was raised before. you know, did you know about this before? Is this the first time you ever heard of it? Put it this way, the last time, my recollection of what happened was there was some exposure or some kind of discussion about forced labor or improper or substandard working conditions on the boats. The competent authority at that time is who? And competent authority is the Customs and Border Patrol.
Sure.
Customs and Border Patrol makes their declaration. They did their investigation, drew the conclusion that there was no evidence of a problem, and their response was post a placard or a sign down Pier 17 in the different languages of the foreign crew to alert them to a call-in number if they have any problems to voice their complaints. Tell you the truth, that for me, the outcome of that investigation of CBP under Homeland Security is what triggered me to just basically not pursue any more, not not pursue this issue any further because the competent authority will take care of it.
Okay. Just one more.
That's the only reason for being.
So are there other things that you see now that perhaps you might want to standardize across the board to provide better protections?
Again, with the better protections, we're not done with the assessment yet.
Okay.
So we have no idea what we're going to uncover, which is why we can't really come forward and vouch for everyone. And so I think the responsible thing to do is rather than just pounding our fists and saying that the article is inaccurate and unfair, is to go take care of business. Take care of business means not trying to try us in the media, but just try to figure out what the issue is. So we come up with the real assessments of how would you assess whether or not there's trafficking or forced labor. That's the number one question you've got to answer. And once that question or that question is answered, we really hope you can lose the slavery or slavery-like conditions out of the category, because we need to cover that first. These, so far, the crewmen that I've spoken to, and I'm not doing the survey, the crewmen that I've spoken to all are very happy with their jobs, and they are their success stories in their countries that people are depending on. That we need to make sure that people, we've got to make sure we don't try to fix this problem for them and lose their jobs. So, but I also agree that any vulnerabilities or exposures to a situation that could be, could encourage or place them at risk, permanent risk, for forced labor or mistreatment on the boats. And I think we need to ferret it out and take care of it. I absolutely, with everybody carrying the signs, I'm right there with that.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, Rep. Yomani.
Thank you, Chair. Actually, hearing both of you brought up a question. So let's say something like this is done, this universal crew contract, which is, you know, asking for Hawaii-based fishermen or Hawaii-based boats to complete. How likelihood then would be if these, let's say, some of these that are, you know, we're concerned about who are doing practices that are not consistent, can they go then and just move their boats from Hawaii to California, fish out of a different state, and then just come to the fish auction, sell their fish, and then leave? And then basically, so we're not addressing the problem, we're just moving it from the state of Hawaii to another state that might not have any regulations.
Well, thanks for that. You know, the thing about this, for the longline fishing operations, generally these guys are holding Hawaii-based permits, and they are able to land in California if they fish that far east. They can't fish within 200 miles of California, but they can land there. We, as an association, and I'm not part of the association, the Hawaii Longline Association doesn't have any real control or jurisdiction over where they land, where they go. And so we're really looking towards a market-based solution, because what we can get from assistance from government that has authority or jurisdiction over the situation. But the market-based program is really through, if you're going to buy through the auction, fish auction here, has already created a situation where they would be looking at evidence, looking at the crew contract.
Okay, so long story short then, is when you sell the fish at the auction, do you have to be a Hawaii-based crew, or Hawaii-based boat, Hawaii-registered fishing boat?
To my knowledge, I don't see a lot of fish, and there's people from the auction.
Oh, you're at the auction coming up now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
You can ask them.
Okay, so then the other question that would be is, if, you know, it was stated that if majority of the fish is being flown in or brought in and not through our local, you know, our local fishermen, is there a way, or have you guys looked at a way regarding putting in mandatory internal or self-regulating procedures within the industry? So other than just this, is there internal protocols in which, if you're not part of an association and you're just fishing and you have these permits through DLNR, who regulates that?
So there's something remarkable happening where the gaps in governance are being filled by companies, coalitions of companies because they're not protected by the law, or they're liable to law, and there's no good oversight yet. So there is a coalition called the Sustainable Shrimp Task Force, which is led by Costco and a number of countries, companies that were called out on the same issue for Thai shrimp a few years ago. They're expanding now into tuna. And there is, I think even more importantly, a really concerted effort at the federal level to bring the tools companies need to handle this, whether it's a fleet or single company or like a retailer having hundreds of seafood items or like a boat. They have a toolkit which we follow. The Department of Labor has what they call the Social Responsibility Toolkit. And it is based on best practice globally from the UN, which is a guiding principles on business and human rights that defines exactly what to do. The good news is that this issue has, you know, a lot of food buyers have dealt with this issue in tomatoes in other foods before, or buyers at Costco have dealt with it in cotton. You know, so there is a track. There is a really clear set of procedures that companies can adopt to know what to do. And the only thing that is challenging is that we're in this transition where companies need to accept that it's their responsibility. So it's all kind of clear what you do when. You just hope not to run into it backwards through a media story.
Thank you, Jack.
So I would add just one more comment to it. Is really what you're asking for in some of the market-based solutions turn out to be third-party audit systems. And so that's kind of where it's going. So I'm not quite sure if the federal government's looking at putting in place, because I'm not really aware of this, but putting in place these restrictions are requirements for imports. And I remember that, so if those numbers are right, and I believe they are, that over 90% of our seafood is actually coming from overseas, where we have limited jurisdiction, number one, limited oversight. So you're pretty much left to these third-party audits for the foreign fleets. And how you get on these some of these foreign vessels that are transshipping at sea and getting to them is the real problem. We have fishermen that are coming back into port every 3 weeks. You can get them, you're right here. But what about the fishermen that stay on the water in freezer, you know, with freezer capacity and are transshipping to carrier vessels? That's where you're going to have these situations where fishermen are stuck on boats for the rest of their lives because they can't come into port. And so that's why this is a very, very different situation. I think we've got the checks and balances here. I still believe that the U.S. fishermen, U.S. managed fisheries, federally managed fisheries, even state fisheries here, that we're good actors in comparison, and so we'll get. And it's no excuse. We need to figure out what's out there. Obviously, if we take any class of workers, we can find a handful of guys that are disgruntled with by not getting paid the same amount as the next guy. That type of thing. Let's get down to some.
Okay, was that the basic, your question answered?
Basic.
Yeah.
All right, I think Chair.
Yeah, thank you. There's been quite a bit of discussion about the confinement of foreign workers to the boat. And, you know, in discussion, my understanding is that they're not necessarily required to just stay on the boat, but there's some flexibility on that. Can you tell us more about that?
Okay. Yeah, thank you. That's one of the concerns. And, you know, we think about what is humane treatment for anyone, to be confined on a vessel or not. Well, by the federal law, the federal position is through Homeland Security is yes, they're coming in, they're not actually coming into the country. And so without a visa, you're not going to go walking around Honolulu. So the compromise or the basically the policy of CBP, the Customs and Border Patrol, is to allow them to walk, get off the boat at Pier 38, Pier 17, walk around the dock, stretch their legs, use the facilities there, but not go into town. So yeah, that is allowed. That's permitted, and that's the policy of CBP.
My understanding is that there has been some effort regarding creating some respite centers at these facilities. I'm not sure if you're the right one to.
I'm not the one to comment on, but is Jim still here? Sean still here?
No, he left.
Do you have
Actually, Chris, maybe you can comment on that, but Sean, can you comment on that? You heard the question.
Because Jim and these folks, they have like jurisdiction or development jurisdiction over the piers, right? So they're saying privately, the question is privately, could they provide these?
Oh, yes, there are plans for it. I just couldn't talk to you about the plans. The plans, what you're talking about is to create basically a recreation and respite center for the floor improvement down Pier 38. And so, yes, the Pier 38 is a fishing village, commercial fishing village, operates like a condominium, and that the group that is operating down there is interested in planning and developing and building showers, facilities for them, like a basketball court, that type of thing, washer dryer, laundry facilities for the floor crew. And so that'd make it a little bit more hospitable for them. So yes, those plans are in order. And again, that's something that's very positive. And I think we'll hear from Dr. Chris later about some of the activities that are taking place.
Okay, we're going to have to cut away now. Thanks for joining us.
To get some inputs on what they find with the airport.
Thank you. Tom, you mentioned the survey, the working condition survey that's being done. When do you expect that to be completed?
It's underway right now. That survey is going to visit vessels, to inspect vessels and to interview the crew. The person that's doing it is the only person we define that actually has ever done this particular job in Hawaii on these vessels. So she was really very well prepared, uniquely qualified, hit the ground running.
That's
she's
Amy
one.
Goff.
Amy Goff. Yeah, Amy Goff. She's one of the two authors of the first
study. She did the study back, the NOAA study back in 2006. Is that
published
right?
In 2006.
On the Filipino
Filipino crew and some of the other crew. It's a good read. It's a little bit long, but it's a good read. And she is, you can imagine trying to get on vessels, number one, and dealing with fishermen and then dealing with the crew. You have to hit the ground running. It takes time to build a rapport. She's already had a rapport. So to answer your question, she's here for 4 weeks to get as much done as possible. And then I think we're looking at maybe 2 weeks after that for some kind of assignment or assessment report.
Thank you.
Maybe Jim could better answer this question, but you said that $350 a month is what some of these foreign workers have been contracted to make. What is the American standard?
Again, I'll only comment on what I know to be true about American fishermen. Most American fishermen are independent contractors on board. They work for a crew share. So there's a lot of concerns or some of the criticism about fishing being equated to an hourly wage.
Oh, I just said per month. So what's the standard for American workers per month?
Well, I guess
zero.
Or the market rate.
It's zero because they get a share.
They get a share.
It's the same in UK law.
What did they expect?
Well, it's a share.
So I guess it depends on the fishery.
What's the average?
Well,
it's
again,
it's
if you're an Alaska king, that Alaska king crab crew.
Well, average is a comp for
a lot of big
more discrepant. What's the average? Like, what should you? What's the market rate?
Yeah, I don't know. There's supposed to. I believe there is a study coming out soon that would address that.
So you can't say like if you're an American longliner makes.
It's like saying
makes,
it would be the same question as what is the average rate?
Yeah, or like
you can answer.
But it's kind of distinguished that here.
No, there is statistics about what the average lawyer, or waiter, or doctor,
right.
and there's
and
a lot of discrepancy.
I've
been
sharing studies with you about the averages globally.
But what I'm telling you is that I don't know.
Okay. I thought you kind of like, there's been like this paradoxical reality painted of, these folks are free to go, and there's no traffic conditions, and when you interview them, they're going to be, say, we're happy with our work. My first job was picking pineapples, and it was very difficult. We had one water break all day. If somebody were to come in and say, are you happy with the conditions, and my Luna standing right there, I'm going to say absolutely. I wasn't. know, do you think those types of questionnaires or observers that sit on the boats are reliable in that sense?
I'll answer that. As far as the protocol, the crew interviews right now are taking place without the presence of the skippers, so if that helps. But once again, you have to be very careful about how you ask questions and what kind of answers you're going to get, right?
Yeah.
Because if somebody feels that their job is threatened and they very, very much value these jobs,
right,
what are they going to do? Just like what you're saying.
Well, do they have to pay for their own food and clothing?
No, they're not supposed to do that.
Okay.
Doing that, no.
Is there a penalty for going home? Do they have to pay for their ticket back?
I don't know that.
Because the answer has to be no, because otherwise it's inherent arrest.
I don't know that. If they, at the end of their contracts, I believe they are paid, but if they break their contracts, it's an issue.
So by breaking their contract, it says, look, I need to go home right now. Okay, but you have to pay this amount. So economically, they are under duress. Economically, they're confined.
Okay, I'll say right now, I'm not the right person to ask that. I don't operate boats and I have no contracts.
Can I share those?
This just goes to the universal contract, or how it could be amended, or how it could be strengthened. Because you're saying that the purpose of the universal contract is to make sure human trafficking is not happening. Well, human trafficking is defined by whether or not these people can go home, if they want to go home. If they cannot, because they're going to get fined by, or they can't afford it, or their contract, $350 a month, is going to cost $700 to get back, you are a confined. You don't have that agency to return home.
I'll share the definition for forced labor worldwide. So there's a kind of catchphrase now, modern day slavery, which encompasses human trafficking, which is selling and buying and selling a human being. And generally, I mean, just to be real broad about it, and forced labor. So forced labor has a very particular definition. Otherwise, you know, there's a lot of subjectivity, right? So the definition is all work or service which is exacted from any person under the menace of any penalty and for which the person has not offered himself voluntarily. That's the International Labor Organization definition that the U.S. Department of Labor works with as well. So from that stems many tools and contracts and responsibilities, including the United States government actually monitors the production of goods worldwide for forced labor using this definition, and the Trafficking and Victims Protection, I'm mixing an R, Act, TVPRA, they're obliged every year to track forced labor in the production of goods. And if you are interested,
okay,
anybody
I'm
can
sorry.
Get the app. It's really an amazing thing. It's called Sweat and Toil.